Welcome to the 9th Distinguished Canadian Annual Address. We're thrilled today with our speaker, General Romeo Dallaire. And before we start, I should tell you I'm Tony Cicerone, Coordinator for Canadian Studies at Bridgewater State College. And I would like to thank at this time TD Bank North for their support for this program. And I also want to thank the Canadian government for their continued support of Canadian Studies at Bridgewater State College. And now it is my pleasure to introduce the President of Bridgewater State College, Dr. Dana Mollifaria.
Thank you very much, Dr. Cicerone. It is great to be here, and I really want to welcome our special guest. And I think after I've introduced him and he has spoken with you, you'll understand why he is such a special guest today. I also want to thank all of you for being here with us today for this 9th Distinguished Canadian Address. If you have not attended these addresses in the past, I will tell you they've been stimulating, they've been interesting, and they've been great for our campus. And I'd like to welcome back our good friend to the campus, Mr. Neil LeBlanc, who is Canada's Consul General to New England. The Government of Canada continues to offer very generous support for our Canadian Studies program, and we are very grateful for that support and for that friendship. I'd also like to recognize our corporate partner, which Tony just did, but I want to reiterate, they've been very supportive, and that is TD Bank North for their ongoing sponsorship of this distinguished lecture series. Today, it is my great pleasure and privilege and honor to introduce today's special guest, Canadian Senator Romeo Dallaire. Senator Dallaire is a highly decorated veteran and former Lieutenant General of the Canadian Armed Forces. As a military leader, Lieutenant General Dallaire served as the force commander of the United Nations Assistance Mission to Rwanda, an experience he recounts quite critically in his best-selling book, Shake Hands with the Devil. During his time in Rwanda, he saw firsthand how the international community had failed to stop one of the worst genocides of the 20th century. Now retired from the armed forces, Senator Dallaire has worked to improve the general public's understanding of post-traumatic stress disorder, and he continues to be a proactive observer and analyst of international issues. At the same time, he serves as a fellow of the Carr Center for Human Rights Policy at Harvard University and works as a special advisor to the Canadian federal government. Friends and colleagues, I am absolutely delighted to welcome to the Bridgewater campus Senator Romeo Dallaire.
Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and Monsieur President, and Monsieur Leblanc, thank you very much for being here. And I gather that some of you may be leaving before I finish my talk because of football practice or whatever else, maybe even a class. And so, as my Marine Corps friends taught me when I was on exchange with them in Virginia, I'm going to power talk and try to get as much as possible through. And my aim this afternoon is to give you a feel of what a middle power like my country, what a middle power like my country might be doing a lot more in regards to a superpower, which is their next door neighbor. And hopefully with that, give you a feel for some questions. At the end of it, although there's no test and I can't promise you any credits with this afternoon, I hope at least to pique your interest and give you a sense that when you look at the weatherman's map on the TV and you see north of the United States a big gray mass, that in fact there is a country there and there is more than snow. To start this, what I would like to do is the opportunity to present itself because you got such excellent technology here. Is to show you a trailer of a feature movie that's just been released in Canada on my book. And I hope that sets a bit of the scene for what we'll get to. So, having tested it several times and going to push my luck with technology, why don't we try to see if the trailer works? Okay, I'll push my luck once again. And what I would like to do is use PowerPoint. As I'm a very visual person, and being a visual person, I need every pedagogical tool I can find, as you can see, so I'm going to use PowerPoint to get my point across this afternoon. And what I hope to do is to give you a feel of the era in which we're in and how the players are involving themselves beyond our borders and not necessarily purely internally, and what our sense, in fact, of this era is, an era that is global, not only in the economics and certainly not only in the general politics, but global in the sense of environment, global in the sense of human rights, of democracy, and we are at a time where we can literally influence the whole of humanity. We can actually reach all of humanity, and this in itself is an indication of a new era in which, through the internet and other similar systems, as they become cheaper and more prevalent, we can actually know within minutes what is in fact going on in the world, and we can ultimately even influence it. Which then brings us to the question, is do we live our history today? Do we live the future today? Or in fact, do we try to isolate ourselves? And what is the future? For that, obviously, for you, the students here, is a great concern. Is the future something that's way out there, or is maybe the future a lot closer? Well, I thought I'd use a great American philosopher to help me bring this to the point. I mean, the fact he played baseball only gives him that much more credibility, I suspect, these days, although I'm not too sure about the Boston Red Sox, but anyways, we can talk about that separately. The future ain't what it used to be, because the future is no more an evolutionary process. In fact, since, and as a reference point, the end of the Cold War, particularly 1989, and that's as many call this era the postmodern era, we're discovering that the future is not something that we and my generation perceived. The future, when I was 23, or 19, or 20, was something 25 years down the road when I'm old at 45. Today, with the rhythm of change, which is in fact more than change, it's reforming, it's even revolutionary. You get a retired general who's got a good job talking about revolutions, don't worry about it. You get some colonels in uniform talking about revolution, you make sure you throw them in jail right away. But we are in a revolutionary era. The future is 5 years down the road, 6 years down the road. So much as societal changes, technology changes, the international evolution of the impacts of nation states against each other, and also the enormous impact in the developing world of their adaptation to this era and their massive numbers of implosions that have been going on as they try to grasp the situation that the world is offering them, particularly the developed world. We hear of the 20% of the haves versus the 80% of the have-nots. We, the 20% of the haves, who actually say that, you know, humanity's advancing. Pretentiously, we argue that. You know, we're mastering technology, we are intellectually rigorous. Of course, humanity is advancing. We're off to Mars. How can we pretentiously say that humanity is advancing when we know that 80% are still in the mud, in the blood, and the suffering? Is it logical? Is it, in fact, ethical to argue that point? And so we're in a time where we are not living in isolation or ignorance of what's going on in humanity. On the contrary, it's with us. And we are in an era where globalization is going to expand and maybe, with a bit of luck, might be, in fact, the useful instrument for humanity of the future versus the perceptions as we now have, as it's being maneuvered, particularly in the business world, as maybe being something that is not necessarily progressive. And so that future, well, we have three options for the future. We've either got an option of surviving it. You know, what do we do? Well, we hope that it doesn't come here. That is to say, we hope the problems don't come here. We hope that we can, in fact, carry on as we've been doing and continue to live a life of relative affluence in the world and as such be in an isolation. In fact, we could, in fact, take a more stringent position, particularly after 9/11, and actually want to build a wall. I mean, there was all kinds of talk after 9/11 of building a wall around North America. And it's extraordinary. I mean, there are a lot of people believe that. I mean, we can actually prevent people with black mustaches from coming into the country. I mean, we'll sort that out. Of course, in the extreme, as we try to build a wall, we might end up with also a police state. We might end up by, in fact, all our civil liberties going down the tubes, or even our beliefs in human rights with torture. We can actually see that go down the tubes. We can throw away most of the conventions that have taken centuries to build. We can throw that out also. But we might be safe. And ladies and gentlemen, in 2004, at the elections of President Bush, I was at Harvard at the time, and I saw, even in the more liberal dimensions of this country, to what extent 9/11 has affected the psyche of the American people, to what extent it feels now vulnerable, which was not at all in the minds of the Americans. In fact, I love going to military institutions, war colleges, staff colleges here in the United States, and I love to stand up there in front of these large classes and start up by saying, I come from a country that beat you guys twice. Once in 1775, and the other time in 1812. In fact, We even pretentiously say we won the War of 1812 because you guys burned down Toronto, but we'd burned down Washington. I think we got the better deal. And so you're in a country that has been hit at home significantly, and your neighbor has all of a sudden realized that maybe also it can't count on the old adage, the old principle that, well, we can take risks with our security because we've got a big brother south of the border. In fact, we had this theory that was applied since 1964 in the white paper, which is a sort of a concept of policy in the country and with the budgets that were approved, that we don't need a significant security capability of defense and so on because we've got our American friends next door. And so with decades, we've attrited our capabilities in that arena because we've accepted a higher risk for our security by counting more on the Americans. And then you get 9/11. But what you really get is 9/12 the next day when the Americans say, hey, that northern border seems like a sieve up there. Maybe we got to do something. And so they call up and they say, we're ready to provide you with assistance in enhancing your security. And what is the first response from the Canadians? Not to be too vulgar about it, who in the hell do they think they are? We're a sovereign state. We can take care of our own defense. Well, if that's the case, you better provide the assets to do it. And so we can't have it in Canada both ways. On the one hand, not wanting to participate because we think that our neighbors are ready to assist us, and when, in fact, the situation becomes tenuous and our neighbors want to assist us, we say, no, 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 we don't want an American occupation. And so, ladies and gentlemen, your neighbor up north has been riding a pretty interesting freebie for a long time and is, in fact, in a position now that it's questioning itself in regards to whether that has been a responsible position with this great neighbor to the south, not created by a sort of an awareness of ethical dimensions, but because of the fact that we're facing a threat that is so complex and difficult to understand, and because you were hit at home. And your home is pretty close to my home. And that has changed the nature. I guess the last element in regards to looking at the future is maybe what we want to do is try to resolve it. Maybe we want to be more proactive with our future. Maybe what we want to do is go to the source of that rage that's expressing itself by extremism, by terrorism, by suicide bombings and so on. Maybe the solution is going there and assisting them to attenuate the rage that they see in the differences that exist in humanity. And we've seen the Muslim world and its impact on the insecurity and its rage. There's nothing, ladies and gentlemen, that prevents the African world of doing exactly the same thing. Sub-Sahara Africa is still being raped in a more sophisticated way, but certainly not less difficult than the colonial era. And just look at what China is doing in Africa. Look at what China has done with Darfur in preventing the UN, preventing the effective and timely deployment of security and diplomatic efforts to try to stop that genocide in Darfur. We have seen the Chinese obstruct that deliberately because the Chinese are in cahoots with the Sudanese government because the Sudanese area is a prime source of oil for China. 71% of all oil revenues going into Sudan is directly going to the military. And it's the military that has created the insecurity with their militias of Darfur. And so we have an option of going beyond our borders. We have an option of, in fact, stop reacting to what's happening to us, but be proactive. We could, in fact, maybe attenuate that rage and ultimately provide not only us, but the rest of humanity with a better chance of surviving the future. And so, how do we do that? And what do we do? And I'm going to rapidly go through that to bring us closer to home. And every now and again, I will bring in, I hope, valid anecdotal information in regards to the United States, and Canada in this world of affairs. This is essentially how a conflict has been analyzed in this era. This era, which is the postmodern era, which is an era that is significantly different from the previous era. We have conflict prevention, we have crisis response, and reconciliation and nation building. What have we been doing so far? It's been 17 years since the end of the Cold War. How are we doing, boss? How's it going? We have discovered that we have not been in any way, shape, or form, except for Macedonia, in any of the conflict prevention. We have been crisis managing. We have been ad hocing responses to crises in the world. We have not been able to get ahead of the game and try to prevent them. We have, in other cases, not even responded to crisis, like Rwanda. We've actually abandoned the crisis with the possibility of assisting afterwards. When I had my mission in Rwanda, I needed $200 million to be able to implement my mission for 2 years. 6 months into the mission, I was still scrounging money from other missions in Mozambique and Sierra Leone and Somalia in order to pay and get the food I needed for my forces. However, after slaughtering 800,000 and with 4 million refugees and internally displaced and the country's infrastructure as little as it was in tatters, we poured in 2 months, $3 billion worth of humanitarian aid. That, ladies and gentlemen, is not good business planning. That is, in fact, not good humanitarian responses. We have been very, very upfront in providing assistance to catastrophic failures. That is to say, assistance in trying to reduce the impact on humanity when it meets certain criteria that we consider efficient. And I bring to mind to you, which will come out later, a film that came out a few years ago called Black Hawk Down. Any of you ever seen it? Okay, Black Hawk Down. 18 Rangers are killed. Their bodies are dragged through the streets of Mogadishu. This is October 1993. In the operation, they killed over 2,000 Somalis. However, with 18 soldiers killed, President Clinton orders the withdrawal of the U.S. forces under the premise that he felt that the American population would not accept casualties on a humanitarian assistance mission. Remember, they were there to try to assist in attenuating the terrible drought and hundreds of thousands of Somalis that were dying because of it. And so with 18 soldiers killed, 72 injured, professional soldiers, the Americans pulled out and abandoned the Canadians, the Pakistanis, the Italians, the UN, and worse, the hundreds of thousands of Somalis. And so we had a start of a reaction by the senior leadership in the world in regards to a premise regarding humanity. Are all humans human? Or are some more human than others? Do some humans actually count more than others? Did those 18 soldiers count more than the hundreds of thousands of Somalis? In the first days in Rwanda, some of the leading nations came in, that took a look, and reported back to their countries. And one of them, in the debrief, simply said the following: "General, we are not recommending to come in and try to stop this genocide." At the time was mass slaughter. "And the reason we're coming in and we're not coming in is because there's nothing here. There is no strategic resources here, oil or whatever. There is no strategic value in this country. We don't even need the place to put a radar screen. The only thing that are here are human beings, and there's too many of them anyways. It's terribly overpopulated." And so we've entered an era that has some pretty different premises than maybe the era before of the Second World War, the era even of the Cold War, of classic warfare. And so let's look at that very rapidly and bring us into the present. This is maybe a bit simplistic, but essentially, that's what was out there, behind the scenes. Didn't bother us too much, because we had an equilibrium in the Cold War. We had the West, led by the United States and NATO, and we had the East, which was the Warsaw Pact. And we had a balance between the two. We had millions and millions of people in uniform, and we were spending billions into the trillions in defense. We even had a sort of an equilibrium on the nuclear side of the house. And that sort of Eurocentric stability kept everybody else reasonably in line. We did have Vietnam, yes, and that initiative there, and that difficult situation. But essentially, it was all focused on Europe. And it was based on classic warfare, the classic use, ultimately, of force if the political diplomatic failed. And so centuries of development of doctrines and concepts of security, both in the diplomatic arena, the military arena, and so on, culminated in the Cold War. And in so doing, provided a sort of, if not stalemate, balance under which we could do our thing, which we did, and did it very successfully. And it was overseas. It was there in Germany and so on. And so we had an era of that relative stability in which we had pretty well all the answers. This is an example of a conservative classic general's dream. This is the first Gulf War. Why? First of all, it's a small map. Secondly, big arrows. They're going in a similar sort of an AKIS principle. Keep it simple, student. We're going to attack from the left going right. And one morning, this big burly general, American general called Schwarzkopf, sort of got up and opened the flap of his tent. And he looked at the sun and studied the entrails of a pigeon and said, go. And when he said, go, ladies and gentlemen, 600,000. 600,000 men and women with the most modern weaponry that technology could develop as a result of Cold War, with the most sophisticated training and doctrines to maximize those weapons, and with a logistic tail that could keep them in the field and sustain them ad vitam aeternam. And he took on another classic army, the Iraqi army of about 400,000. And they went at each other, and they beat each other up. And they simply did what was there, the essence of all that technology, was attrition warfare. The one left standing wins. And that's essentially what happened. But if you look at the last 17 years, there's only been two occasions where classic warfare has been used. Then, and in 2003, with the invasion in Iraq. Invasion in Iraq. A single nation-led coalition outside of the UN decides to take on and rectify a situation in a country where there is a rogue leader, there are rogue generals, and a rogue army, yes? And so that coalition went into Iraq. My country said, we're not going. And the decision was taken because that mission, that context, was not sanctioned by the UN. It was not sanctioned by the UN. And ladies and gentlemen, even with its problems, there is no body in the world, there is no single nation in the world that can have the transparency and the impartiality of the UN. Every time you look at a single nation-led coalition going in somewhere, there's always the doubt on the ulterior motives beyond democracy and humanitarianism. And facile responses are, oh, we went in there because of oil. I would contend that maybe we're there because we're building bases to surround China, because maybe in 10 years we'll be into another Cold War with them. We did it with the Soviets. Maybe we're doing it with them. But one thing is for sure, is that that coalition went in. Where were the middle powers? The middle powers. You are the superpower. There are great powers. Take the other members of the Permanent Five, China and Russia, the Brits, the French. Where were they? Well, the Brits joined in, the French stayed off, the Russians are fiddling, and the Chinese are still hedging their bets as they rape the rest of the world for their resources they need. But where were the middle powers? Where was Japan, Germany, Canada, Italy, regional middle powers, maybe India? Where were they in this exercise? Where was my country the next day of the invasion? Well, in most cases, my country was sort of sitting smug, congratulating the Prime Minister for not joining in, and sending rather disparaging comments towards the United States. And that's where I think we failed. I think this is one of the examples of how a middle power has failed the superpower. We failed because, essentially, we failed the Iraqis and, ultimately, the mission. That this great power can take on another great army in classic or semi-classic use of force, fine. It was a rogue army. It was a rogue corps of generals. It was a rogue leader. You go in there and do it. But what my country should have been doing with the other middle powers is saying, listen, take on that army and defeat it, okay. But don't go into Baghdad. Let us go in. We don't carry any baggage. We don't carry a colonial baggage. We don't carry any sort of perceived imperial baggage. Let us go in with the UN flag and stay out there in overwatch if the situation goes to pot. We did not offer that option. It wasn't asked for, but we didn't offer it. And so, ladies and gentlemen, we're not in an era of simplistic sort of, we're going in, we're going to beat the guy up, and then we're going to throw a Marshall Plan at them and help them rebuild. We're in an era of far more complexity and far more nuances. However, we also see that maybe the leadership, as we're looking through this complex era, might not necessarily be up to the snuff. Maybe we're getting a lot of political decisions, a lot of management of problems, but we're not necessarily getting a lot of leadership, a lot of solving of problems, and maybe not the level of statesmanship we need to bring these solutions about. Statesmanship, the humility of statesmanship, the innovative thinking, the risk-taking that statesmanship comes, that leadership articulates, that can anticipate the future and proactively align us versus being a crisis manager that ultimately passes the problem on to somebody else. And so an era where the war, classic war, didn't seem to be the norm and certainly doesn't seem to be a solution, and nor this peacekeeping, classic peacekeeping. You remember the blue beret with short pants and a baseball bat? So the referee, two sides fight, and historically have been countries at each other since 1956 in Suez. At the time, he was the foreign minister. Lester Pearson invented the peacekeeping, and we deployed it to Suez for the first time. This referee, where both sides say, yeah, we want peace, and we just need somebody to make sure we play by the rules. Well, that was, in fact, my mission. A demilitarized zone, an army north of it, an army south of it. They're in their trenches, we got a peace agreement, and we're in there to help them in the process. But what we discovered in the 90s is classic peacekeeping didn't work either. We're not facing countries attacking each other to gain land or resources as such. What we've seen in the 90s and still ongoing today is imploding nations. Nations that in fact, due to historic references in many cases, and more modern, not wanting to share power, they are going into civil war and massive catastrophic failure. And so we've seen it throughout Africa and other countries, how, in fact, the trying to use classic peacekeeping tools didn't work. In Rwanda, you got a country that was 100-odd years under colonial rule. In 1959, they throw away and get rid of the colonial rule. They create a massive exodus. But then also, they fall prey to us in the Cold War, where we essentially bought off a dictator to keep the country under wraps. These artificial countries that were created by the colonial powers. And so for nearly 30 years, the country was under a dictator that we supported. At times it was the other side, then us, and we supported a lot of those dictators because we didn't want to go to World War III over hassles going on in Tanzania and stuff where we might be creating frictions that could degenerate into a war. So we bought off these guys. And then in 1990, pressures from the outside world brought it that these people wanted back home, and we have an internal civil war. 3 years of civil war, we have a peace agreement, but then we have the new angle in this era, significant angle, that some people signed this thing under duress. Some elements, Rwandan, not foreign, amongst themselves signed under duress and realized that they were going to lose their shirt, realized that this peace agreement was not going to work. And so one night, these extremists decided that the only way they're going to stop this thing, this peace agreement, this sharing of power with the ex-dictator and his party, was by essentially committing a genocide and wiping out 1,200,000 people. And they nearly did. They wiped out over 700,000, plus 100,000 of their own. Classic peacekeeping, where we observe in a neutral fashion, doesn't work anymore either. So war classic doesn't work, and peace doesn't work, but we seem to be involved in conflict and everything in between. And so maybe classic war is obsolete. Maybe we are in an era of disorder in which conflict is the norm. Maybe that is the nature of the beast. George Bush Sr. said at the end of the Cold War that we're entering a new world order. And I would contend we entered a new world disorder. We've seen and aware of the massive abuses of human rights. We have seen ethnic cleansing. We've seen genocide. We have seen global terrorism. Terrorism based on them not playing by any of the rules. Humanitarian law, law of armed conflict. Don't play by them. Don't believe in any of them. They kill their own to achieve their aim. And we've even permitted now to create mercenaries and legally hire them. Those security companies out there, there's 25,000 of them in Iraq. What is their ethos? Under what rules are they playing? What's in the contract? How far will they push their people? Will they go as far as a national military force that lives and exists under the unlimited liability clause that they would give their life for the mission? Or do they go as far as the next paycheck? What do you do with these characters? And what are their methods of operations? And so we leapt to all these sort of innovative solutions without necessarily looking at the full impact. And so, a complex era. This is the Pearl Harbor of liberal democracies because the response to this has been panic. It hasn't been sedate leadership, it's been panic. It's been panic here, and it's been panic in the developed world in particular. And we have fiddled with so many of the principles and bases of our societies in order to try to figure out how do we counter a threat that doesn't play by any of the rules. These are the rules. This is what the world evolved on. This is what the classic warfare era had evolved to. The extremist dimension in many of these ethnic-based, religious-based, tribal-based, and power-sharing-based conflicts in many of these imploding nations and the ramifications of that beyond are based on the fact that the guys and girls who are running it don't play by any of the rules. And we are being pushed by our panic and our inability to provide new solutions to this to go down the same road. I mean, how do you control torture if you permit it to happen? You're allowed pulling out toenails but not fingernails? I mean, what's the control mechanism? And so, ladies and gentlemen, we are in a complex era. We're in a time frame where the solutions are not necessarily obvious. A time frame where dictators are using, as organizations, extremism, barbarism, in order to achieve their aims. They are not dummies. We like to treat them as dummies. They are not. One of the reasons why? They go to the same schools you go to. They graduate with the same courses you do, be it in Toronto, Montreal, New York, here, in Paris, London. They are well educated. They know how to maneuver the international community. They know how to figure out how the system works. They know how to influence their people. They are not dummies. They are well-educated, well-developed, and focused people. But they are ruthless and will do anything to achieve their aims and are not constrained by any of the fundamental laws and premises that we are. They are not high-tech. That really has thrown us for a curve. We're all high-tech. This militiaman, half drunk, with a machete and a couple grenades, is not high-tech. Easy to get rid of, but when they come at you in thousands, how do you handle them? Where's his uniform? What laws is he applying by? How is he being conducted and controlled? Who's running that guy? And so we find ourselves in facing rather unusual circumstances, and even new weapon systems. This is the most sophisticated, low-technology weapon system on the battlefield today. It started in the late 80s, specifically in Mozambique. An 11-year-old with an AK-47 that he can carry, shoot, clean, and function well with. How do you take care of that? How do you stop that? Do you kill children who kill? Children were abducted. They are in the hundreds of thousands in the world. In over 43 countries, either some countries employing them and others rebel forces, and basing their whole operations on children. A 12-year-old, 13-year-old girl, pregnant with an AK-47, pointed at a soldier who's there to assist them. How do you stop it? How do you stop her from pulling that trigger? What sort of parameters is she working under? How drugged up is she? How many times has she been already raped? What loss of human dignity has she had? Do you stop her? And do you ultimately, do you shoot her? And so we find ourselves facing some not only complex scenarios, but scenarios of enormous barbarism and abuse of humanity not seen except in certain circumstances like the Holocaust and very controlled. It is used. Rape is used. What we've entered is an era where the civilian population is a weapon of war and no more just on the sidelines. Rape is not what some rogue soldiers do on the side. It is used to instill fear, to break down social structures. Not only by the fact that the raped women are not acceptable anymore, but the children they create are intolerable to those in those very close societies and often male-dominated societies. And you create fear by instilling horror. And so that's what they do. And the extremists in Rwanda were able to move 4 million people. In Darfur, there are 2.5 million. Moved by fear, created by horror. The Rwandan refugees and internally displaced. The scale of the problems that we face today. The O's represent 1.6 million displaced internally, and the X's 2.3 million refugees. How do we feed 3.9 million people twice a day? How many trucks of food, water, medical supplies, sheeting, wood does it need to keep them going and to avoid them self-destructing? There are, of course, the introduction of many organizations as we try to work this out. Many of the humanitarian efforts are out there. And are they, in fact, part of the solution or maybe part of the problem, as they might be aiding and abetting one of the sides by going in to help, and a lot of the stuff is taken and used by those forces? And so, ladies and gentlemen, we are even in an era where those who are there to help are also the targets. In Rwanda and after 9/11, the correction, after Mogadishu, it was open season on those who were there under the moral reference of the UN. And so it was very clear that the extremists in Rwanda, if they killed 10 white soldiers or a dozen white soldiers or so on, all the white troops would pull out, and they would pull everybody else out, and then we could do what we want. And that's exactly what they did, and that's exactly how the international community responded. We didn't reinforce my garrison to try to stop it. We pulled everybody out. And I was left with about 450 Ghanaians, principally. Why? Because we could not suffer casualties. Because we've established a different criteria for our lives. And even with the Iraq War, or look at Afghanistan, my country has over 2,500 troops there. We have taken 71 casualties. We don't talk about how well we're doing or what we're doing or what infrastructure has been rebuilt. We talk about the casualties. And so if the casualties are the significant factor, then should the people be taking risks to accomplish the mission? And if the people are not taking risks to accomplish the mission, then why send the military? You might as well send Boy Scouts. And will they accomplish it? And so, ladies and gentlemen, we are in a very complex era where ambiguity and complexity are the norms. This is what's there. There's no more good guy, bad guy, white hat, black hat. That is gone. It's gray and all kinds of shades. And in that grayness, we have seen that we've responded in different ways. Are all humans human? Are they to be considered human? Are their lives as worthy as ours? We pulled out of Rwanda, but we reinforced Yugoslavia by tens of thousands of troops and billions of dollars. Why did the Yugoslavs get all that and the Rwandans get nothing? What creates the criteria, the fundamental criteria, in the grand strategic decisions of going in or not, let alone going in to prevent it as we try to crisis manage it? Is there something behind the value of the white European versus the black African? Or is it just because we know the Europeans more? Could it be that they count more? Could it be that there's an interest in them more? If there's something behind that, and it's being used in the grand strategic sense, are we ethical when we talk about human rights? Human rights are for all humans, not just those who got the money to pay for it. Are all humans human? And have we been responding that way? And so this has been the criteria that has come out of not doctrinal and conceptual design, but by reaction, by crisis management. And so, ladies and gentlemen, we find ourselves in an era where still self-interest dominates, and the bigger the country, often the more the self-interest dominates. In an era still where casualties are not acceptable unless our security is threatened. And the lives of other human beings that are not ours are not necessarily those that will attract enough of the political will to take the risk to go in and to stop it. And with that, what are we going to do? Well, if we're in an era that war is obsolete, then we need something else. What is it? And we in the military love these acronyms, and OOTW stands for Operations Other Than War. And so preventive deployment has been used just once in Macedonia and was effective, but it was a very small operation. We have not prevented conflicts. We have crisis managed them or abandoned them. Peacekeeping doesn't work anymore. The classic use of peacekeeping simply does not meet the complexities of the threats and the number of players that are in there. Intervention might be an option. But intervention in isolation of the UN, with all its warts, is a very high-risk exercise and doesn't necessarily provide you with ultimately the long-lasting solution. And humanitarian responses, yes, but very often we want to do it only when the shooting is over and that we can do it safely. And one at times might even wonder whether or not that in itself is not quite a business. I mean, where do we find the money within the first 2 months of after the Rwandan genocide to pay for the $3 billion worth of food and medical supplies? Is there maybe a business in that? Is that not maybe something that some people are gaining from? And so we are in a time particularly post-Somalia, of enormous complexities in trying to find solutions. And we are keeping people accountable, not for accomplishing the mission as priority one, but whether or not they're bringing everybody home safely, whether they're reducing casualties, and ultimately, whether or not the people they're there to help and save are saved or not. And so I will move rapidly that we are in an era of enormous complexities with the legal, moral, and ethical dilemmas that don't have ready solutions. They are not black and white. And so when I went in front of your Senate Subcommittee on Human Rights and the Law, led by Senator Durbin, and the whole debate, we were the first witnesses, Don Cheadle and myself, and the whole debate was, what does the United States do about Darfur? And there was a reaction from the senators there that we should go in and try to sort the place out. And my response to them was the following: why do you continuously insist on setting yourself up to fail? Why do you insist, because you're the world power, to be the world policeman? Why do you insist that your solution, often with the use of military force, is going to provide the best solution not only for those on the ground, but for your own country and your own people, and ultimately the world? Why are you not insisting that others who have capabilities participate? Why are you not kicking Canada in the butt? Darfur, as the example of an ongoing genocide today, where even your president has called it a genocide, has seen no response from the developed world. We've had the African Union in there for a couple of years. Now we're bringing in a hybrid UN force. We've let the Sudanese tell us that they cannot be non-Africans or non-Muslims, and we're getting away with it. From overreaction to non-action by the superpower, but what are you doing to get the middle powers involved? Why are they not paying a bigger price? It would be interesting that, in fact, the Secretary General of the UN and the Security Council have an option that not just turning towards the big powers of potentially having to carry the can in many of these complex missions, that they had another tier of people that they could turn to assist. And not necessarily the developing countries that don't have the technology, the competencies to be able to bring solutions to those problems in the field. Why don't the Germans change their constitution to be able to deploy troops and diplomats into conflict zones? Why don't the Japanese do it? It's been 60 years. How many years do you carry this thing? Why doesn't Canada, 31 million people, part of the G8, one of the strongest economies of the world, why can't it put more than a couple thousand troops in the field? Why is it not being imposed upon to carry some of the burden to offset the use of the big powers by middle powers who might have a bit more credibility in the eyes of those in which those countries are being assisted, of not having any ulterior motive than, in fact, advancing human rights, good governance, rule of law, gender equality? And so, ladies and gentlemen, we're right in being in Afghanistan. We're absolutely right in being in Afghanistan to assist a nascent democracy that's asked the UN for help. And we're helping it on the military side through NATO. And it is absolutely crucial that we move right behind the security forces, the development efforts, and the diplomatic and political efforts to build the infrastructure of those nations, the rule of law, and the schools, and the good governance, and so on. It is absolutely crucial. And we stay there until we succeed. And we take the casualties of that. But why are we doing it in Afghanistan and we're not doing it in Darfur? And if the answer is we don't have the resources, then the question is, where were those millions of soldiers that were out there in Europe when we were in the Cold War protecting us. What happened to them all? What's happened to all that technology that was there? What happened to all the technology in the Gulf War? Why are we picking and choosing? And why are countries riding on the coattails of the big boys? Or standing aloof and giving them a hard time? Instead of providing innovative options and resources to the UN as an example, in order to offset having the big powers get involved too soon and ultimately pull out. For it is one thing to use force, but if you are attrited, if you, the world power, pull out, what credibility is left to the rest of us? When Bill Clinton pulled you guys out of Mogadishu, we had nothing left. So why'd you go in before? Why didn't you support others? When the big superpower gets a bloody nose and turns tail, there is nothing left behind it. And so, ladies and gentlemen, we have got to keep this country in reserve. This country has got to be the overwatch. This country has got to be there with political will and some strategic assets. But countries like mine have got to be in the forefront, have got to be on the ground, trying to make it work, with no ulterior motives through the UN. And if we fail, then bring in the big boy who knows and has the capability of sorting it out, if we fail. But the mere fact of not using the power of this country, but in fact being able to build on the potential use of power, on the threat of use of power, is far, far, far more effective than in fact getting in up to your ears, being attrited, getting a bloody nose, and turning tail. This world can't afford the United States to be like that, but the United States cannot afford continuously being set up to fail because others are hedging their bets and not stepping up to the plate. Thank you very much.